Okay, we're about halfway through lesson 7. Were there any questions on anything we looked at last week? We concluded by looking at just portions of this book, The Defense Never Rests. The apologetic book that defends the Christian faith based on really external evidence. Not so much just, well, it's written in the Bible, and so you either believe it or you don't. There actually are things that you can look at and things that you can assess that are outside of or external from the Bible. And that's one of the things that this lawyer, Mr. Craig Parton, takes a look at in his book. It's a good one. I would recommend it if anybody wanted. I have a copy of it. If you don't want to buy it, if you'd like to borrow it from me, you can do that too. But we also then spent a lot of time just looking at the accounts of the resurrection. If there aren't any questions, what we're going to get into tonight are really two things. First is, we're going to look at the meaning and purpose of the resurrection. I think some people are under this impression that Jesus rising from the dead, page 44, I think, top of page 44 in your notes. I think a lot of people look at the resurrection and just kind of conclude, well, it's part of the story, right? It makes it unique. It makes it interesting. It makes it different. But what we're going to see tonight is that the resurrection is actually necessary. If Jesus had only died and was buried and never rose from the dead, I wouldn't be a Christian. You wouldn't be a Christian. There would be no Christians. And if they were, they would be complete and utter fools. Because they would be part of a religion that is no different than any other religion in the world, whose religious leader came up with a lot of great ideas, gave a lot of great encouragement, and then eventually died and stayed dead. That's really what you have in every other world religion. Whether it is the prophet Muhammad, whether it is Buddha, whether it is any of the Eastern, Middle Eastern, Far Eastern religions, that's really what all of them come back to, is worshiping a god or following a teacher who died and stayed dead. Christians do not. We have someone totally different. So, let's take a look at that. Top of page 44, the meaning and purpose of the resurrection. A couple of verses from 1 Corinthians chapter 14. 15. 1 Corinthians 15 is one of my favorite chapters in the entire Bible. It is the single longest chapter, if you look at the amount of words in it. It's the longest chapter in the entire New Testament. And there's a reason for that. The entire purpose of 1 Corinthians chapter 15 is to detail and talk about the resurrection of Jesus Christ. Its nickname is the Great Resurrection chapter of the Bible. And the point of it the Apostle Paul is making is, apparently, some of the people in Corinth, this city where this Christian congregation was founded, started to kind of doubt this idea of the resurrection of the dead. Not necessarily so much that Jesus himself had not risen from the dead, but the idea in general. They really were starting to question whether or not after people die, do they rise from the dead? And the Apostle Paul uses Jesus to base his whole argument on. That it really, this idea of the resurrection from the dead begins and ends with Jesus. And these are some of the things that he says. If Christ has not been raised, our preaching is useless and so is your faith. You want to call yourself a Christian, but you don't believe in the resurrection of the dead, then you cannot say that even Christ was not raised from the dead. And if Jesus Christ has not been raised from the dead, then why do you call yourself a Christian? A Christian? Why do you put your faith in someone who died and is still dead? Our preaching as ministers of the gospel, as disciples and apostles of Christ, would be worthless, it would be empty, it would be powerless and meaningless. We would be wasting our breath telling you about this man, Jesus Christ, if he has not been raised. He goes on to say a couple verses later, and if Christ has not been raised, your faith is futile. You are still in your sins. That might be the scariest one. This whole problem that you and I have with our sins, if Jesus Christ died and was buried and stayed in his tomb, then you and I still have to deal with our sins. And we've gone over, what does the law say? How is it that we deal with our sins? Be perfect as I, the Lord your God, am perfect. I don't want to deal with my sins. I can't deal with my sins. Either Jesus deals with them totally, completely, 100%, or I have to deal with them completely, totally, 100%. And if Christ has not been raised, I have to deal with them. So, if you look at it, what would sadly be true if Christ had not been raised from the dead? Look at all these things. It's useless to preach the gospel. It's a waste of time, a waste of breath, a waste of resources, a waste of building a congregation like this and maintaining it. It would be futile to believe in Jesus. The object of your faith is a dead man. And finally, you're still in your sins. Those are all the things that would be true if Christ is not raised. Yes?
Fiction.
Yeah. The whole book. Everything in the Bible. None of it matters. Not a single thing. This is the resurrection of Jesus Christ is the linchpin that holds all of Christianity together. And so that book that we looked at last week, The Defense Never Rests, you notice that was what his approach to it was. If I can prove the resurrection of Jesus Christ from the dead, everything else falls into place. If someone can disprove the resurrection of Jesus Christ, it all crumbles. So this really is the foundation of the Christian faith. Easter Sunday is not just, you know, really kind of a fun day or a unique time, or spring is here and we have Easter egg hunts for the kids. It really is the most important day of the year and the most important festival in the Christian church. Because without it, none of the other ones matter. I would encourage you to take a look at 1 Corinthians 15 sometime. It's the amazing things that Paul is able to just logically walk through and talk about as he walks through this. Because here is what his point is. If you're doubting the resurrection as a concept in general, then this thing called the resurrection from the dead is not possible, and therefore Christ has not been raised. You can't say that Jesus Christ rose from the dead, but we're not sure that anybody else will. Because Jesus himself said so. Because I live, you too will live. The point of the resurrection is to prove that those who are in Christ will, like Christ, also one day rise from the dead. So if Jesus rose from the dead, so will Christians. If Jesus did not rise from the dead, then nobody will, and none of this matters.
Okay.
A couple other passages in the New Testament to look at. Romans chapter 4, the Apostle Paul says, Jesus was delivered over to death for our sins and was raised to life for our justification. It might seem like we're splitting hairs here, but each of the things that Jesus does, between his life, his death, his resurrection, they all serve kind of unique and different purposes to ultimately accomplish our salvation. Jesus lived a perfect life. We looked at that verse in our last lesson 6. From Galatians chapter 4, the Apostle Paul says, Jesus was born under the law to redeem those under the law, right? So Jesus needs to live a perfect life because ultimately that's what the law says we have to do. And so we need someone to live God's law perfectly for us. So Jesus does that with his life. so that he can give us that credit. He can give us that perfect status that you and I do not have on our own. Jesus then dies on the cross because you and I have incurred a debt with God. Every time we sin, we dig our debt deeper and deeper and deeper. Someone needed to pull us out of that debt. Someone needed to pay that debt. And the debt was a perfect life. So Jesus dies the death that you and I deserve to pay for our sins, to take them away. He was delivered over to death for our sins. The resurrection of Jesus now is what we see as ultimately God's stamp of approval. What confidence or reassurance when we look at the life, the ministry, the death, the passion, the suffering, everything that Jesus did, what confidence or reassurance do we have that it worked? That it actually did what Jesus said it did? The fact that he rose back from the dead is the proof. He rose again for our justification, to show us that that status of his perfect life, that the payment for our sins, that it is now yours through faith in Christ. That it is now accomplished for you totally and completely. This is God saying, yes, it's done. It's paid for in full. It is all good. And to prove it, God the Father raises his Son back to life. So we don't necessarily use, and I'm giving you one of the answers to our agree-disagree at the end of the lesson, but we don't talk about Jesus rising from the dead to pay for our sins. The Bible reserves that for his crucifixion, for his death. He died. He was handed over to death for our sins. But he was raised back to life to prove that it was all good, that it was all valid, that the payment was accepted. So, here's the contrary then to what we've looked at so far. But if Jesus did truly rise from the grave, then I have every reason to believe I am, use the word right there in Romans 4, justified. And you remember what that word means? That courtroom term. It means to be declared not guilty. Which is really an amazing thing to think of. To hold up the perfect and holy law of God against my life and to say, here's the standard and here's my human heart and here's the record of my life, and I'm walking into God's courtroom who knows and sees all things, what verdict should I expect? Guilty every day of the week, twice on Sunday. But Jesus was raised to life for your justification, that God might declare you not guilty. That's awesome. I mean, that's just justified. Awesome word. Used again and again and again in the New Testament. Another verse, John chapter 11. Jesus said to Martha, outside the tomb of her dead brother. Remember Mary and Martha, the two sisters, Lazarus, their brother. This seems to be a family that Jesus was very, very close to. A family that he loved dearly. In fact, this is the event where we hear Jesus wept. So moved by human emotion, the NIV translates, Jesus' heart went out to, or he felt compassion for. When you see those translations in the New Testament, it's my favorite word in Greek. The word is splachnizomai. Just a fun word to say. It sounds like a Germanized Greek word. Splachnizomai. And literally what it says is Jesus' intestines, his innards, were moved. And there's a reason for that. Back in the ancient world, they thought that your stomach was where your emotions were kept. The seat of one's emotions were found in their stomach. And that makes sense, doesn't it? When you get really excited, where do you feel it? You talk about getting butterflies in your stomach, right? When you're sad, you know, you feel like someone punched you in the gut, you still talk that way. This is an example of Jesus seeing that. He had compassion on these sisters, on this family. And so Jesus says to Martha, outside the tomb of her brother who's been dead for 4 days, He says, I am the resurrection and the life. He who believes in me will live, even though he dies, and whoever lives and believes in me will never die. So follow that logic again. We looked at those passages in 1 Corinthians where Paul said, if Christ has not been raised, then here's what's true. Let's look at the opposite then. What is true if Christ has been raised? Well, then I have every reason to believe I too will live. Okay. So you kind of see the contrast that Scripture uses in both of those. There's a negative side to it. If you don't believe that Jesus rose from the dead, then here are all the things that are true for you. If you do believe that Jesus rose from the dead, here's what it means. Okay. So meaning and purpose of the resurrection. Are there any questions on that section or on just the resurrection in general? Okay. Let's move on then. The last section that we're going to look at tonight is we talked about the various stages of Christ's exaltation at the beginning of the lesson. We looked at each of the phrases that we confess in the Apostles' Creed. On the left side was his humiliation, the stages of his humiliation. That Jesus was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. What we're going to look at now is the right side of that, that kind of valley that we looked at. And look at the five stages of his exaltation. Those words that we get from Philippians chapter 2. So what we're going to look at is, on the left-hand side, you kind of see some boxes there in your notes. On the left-hand side, we're going to read a couple of verses in the Bible that describe or state for us, here is the stage of Christ's exaltation that we're looking at. Okay? Whether it's his descent into hell, his resurrection, his ascension, his return, we'll look at passages that will say, here's what Jesus did. On the right-hand side, then, we're going to read other passages that say, kind of, so what? Okay? What was the purpose and meaning for this stage of Christ's exaltation? Okay? And the first one we're going to begin with is maybe one of the more confusing ones. Because when we confess in the Creed, he was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended into hell. Maybe your mind, like mine, makes the assumption, if you were going to think of the Jesus being humbled and Jesus being exalted, where would you put his descent into hell? Probably not a good thing, right? You would probably tend to put that as part of his humiliation, but it isn't. Because it depends why. Why did Jesus descend into hell? Okay? So let's look at it. First verse we're going to look at there, 1 Peter chapter 3. Peter writes, Jesus was put to death in the body, but made alive by the Spirit. So talking about his death and his resurrection. Through whom, through the Spirit, also he went and preached to the spirits in prison. Okay. Maybe a little cryptic, but I think we can understand. We're talking about spirits, so we're not talking about the physical world, and we're talking about prison. So where in the spiritual realm are there spirits kept in prison? It's a depiction, it's a description of hell. Okay. So what do we see Jesus is doing at his descent into hell? Just use the word that Peter uses. We'll get to that, John. He's preaching. Okay? He's preaching. Now you can talk about it. This is what makes it kind of interesting. Because anytime we typically see Jesus preaching, what would you be safe to assume that Jesus is preaching? Or for what purpose or what reason is Jesus typically preaching? Because he wants to what someone? Jesus preaches to win people, right? To bring them to repentance, to bring them to faith in him. Ultimately, Jesus preaches to save people. And so a lot of people make the assumption, Well, this was Jesus descending into hell, preaching to the demons and to the people who had died and had gone to hell. He was preaching to them to give them a second chance, to get them out of hell. Okay. But let's see. Let's look at another verse that talks about the content of Jesus' preaching. Colossians chapter 2. After Jesus had disarmed the powers and authorities, think about this again in the spiritual realm. The Apostle Paul talks about how your and my battle in this life are not against physical things, but against the powers and authorities in the spiritual realm of the world. So the Apostle Paul encourages us to put on the armor of faith to fight against the devil and his demons. And so here we see Jesus now disarming the powers and authorities, our spiritual enemies. How and when did he do that? When did he defeat Satan and his evil angels? Well, his death and resurrection, right? This is how he disarms them. Satan can no longer accuse you or me of being in our sins because Jesus has taken them away. He's paid that price. This is one of those great things, one of the great lines that Martin Luther had when you get the sense that he was oftentimes tormented throughout his life, especially later on in his life, by the devil, by evil spirits. He could sense these things, and you know whether they were really there or he was just sensing them in things that he experienced in his life. He said he kind of was referencing, I think, his guilty conscience, that we all know what that feels like. And he said, you know, the next time that Satan comes knocking at the door of your heart and wants to accuse you of your sins, look back at him and say, so what? I know I'm guilty. I'm not going to try and talk my way out of it. I'm not going to try and make excuses. Every accusation that you want to throw my way is 110% accurate, Satan. But guess what? I don't have those sins anymore. I'm not guilty of them because through Christ I have been justified. So you're accusing me of something that no longer belongs to me. But Jesus took it to be his own. And where he died, they died. So you're knocking on the wrong door. And I think that's a pretty good way when you're feeling guilty about something for which you've already confessed, for which you've already received forgiveness, and yet you still feel guilty about it. That's what the devil wants you to feel. That's what sometimes we don't allow ourselves to experience or hear or receive forgiveness. That was the response that Martin Luther would give. I thought that was always a good one, so I remember that from time to time. Anyway, after Jesus had disarmed the powers and authorities, here's what he did with them. He made a public spectacle of them, triumphing over them by the cross. So put that together, which is the message that Jesus proclaimed to the powers and the authorities that he had disarmed. That is the content of the message that he proclaimed to the spirits in prison. Put it in your own words. Why did Jesus go? Why did he descend into hell? In order to what? To preach what? Okay, in essence, it was to preach what had been accomplished. Right? He goes there and he triumphs over his enemies. And here's the great irony. If there was ever a moment where there might have been celebration and joy in hell, it would have been only a few days earlier as Jesus breathed his last. Think of the irony. Jesus comes and the devil knows what he's trying to accomplish. The salvation of souls. And yet the very people that he comes to save are the ones who now get rid of him. The devil must have been thinking, I could not have orchestrated this any better. I mean, I tried to tempt him every waking moment of his life. I spent 40 days tempting him in the wilderness nonstop, every waking moment, and he didn't flinch. But look! Look at what his own creation has done to him. Look at what his own people have put him through. This is just beautiful. And then he's buried. And where is the first place that he goes? He goes down into hell to face his enemies face to face. To say, you think you won. But by the very means you thought that you had defeated me, the cross, by that very means is what Jesus used to triumph over his enemies. I mean, the irony is too beautiful. So Jesus goes, yes, in a sense to proclaim the gospel. You're definitely right in that sense, Craig. But not for the same purpose that you and I proclaim the gospel. It was not to go and give the souls, to give the evil angels another chance to believe in Jesus. They were judged. Their eternity is sealed. Jesus goes to ultimately show them, I have won. I have defeated Satan. I have defeated sin. I have defeated death. I have defeated hell itself. That is a proclamation of the gospel in the highest regard. So it isn't, and I think this is, again, one of those areas where a lot of people maybe misunderstand Jesus' descent into hell. It was not for Jesus to suffer more. Okay? When we confess in the creed Jesus descended into hell, we're not talking about him suffering. If we were talking about him suffering, then that would be part of his humiliation. But it's not, because this is what he goes to do. He goes to preach his victory. He goes to proclaim his triumph over his enemies. And by association, your enemies and mine. Any questions on this section? I think this is one of those where Jesus doesn't go to suffer more. He doesn't go to give people a second chance. He simply goes to have a victory parade in hell. To make sure that there absolutely was zero doubts that Christ had died and rose and defeated his enemies. Okay. Thoughts?
Question.
Yeah.
From early on, when the devil know that this is the plan, when you know all these promises that I'm going to send my son, and you believe in that, and all that. So, as far as the celebration, and when he dies, he knows that that's part of the plan, right?
Yeah, yes and no. I think you give the devil more credit than us. Right? This is why we need to put on the full armor of faith, because Satan is more powerful. He's stronger and in many ways wiser than I am. To fight him on my own would be a foolish battle. He is more powerful and stronger and wiser than I am, but he is not on par with God. And what I mean by that is, while he knows many things, he is not omniscient. He does not know all things. Right.
He's gonna die. Yeah.
And remember, ultimately, what makes the devil the devil? He may have known this, but he had also long ago rejected it and rebelled against it. So even if it was something that he had known, and again, to what extent of all the details? I mean, if he still ultimately knew that this was all going on, and this was going to happen, then why waste time tempting him? Right? I mean, he still thought there was a chance. And this is why I say that the first Sunday in Lent, which all the gospel is always Matthew chapter 4, which is the temptation of Jesus, is always just, it's a great section of the Bible to read When you feel like the devil is overpowering you, when you feel like he's defeating you in temptation and sin, to see how foolish the devil is compared to God. The things that he says, right? Just bow down and worship me, and everything that you see, I'll give to you. Are you kidding me? Do you know who you're talking to? The one who created it all. You don't think it already belongs to him? You don't think he realizes that? Now, that's a temptation that certainly would captivate me. But to use that then with the Creator, foolish. Just how stupid he appears in the presence of God. So again, I want to give him more credit than I would give myself. But when it comes to, he's not even in the same ballpark as God. And so I think he still thinks to the bitter end. Even now, he knows that he cannot defeat God. That is done, right? This is the proclamation. The battle is over. But he still attacks God. How? Not by trying, and I mentioned this in a sermon a couple of weeks ago, not by trying to storm the gates of heaven. He tried that. Lost. Mercilessly lost. But he still tries to attack God by attacking his people, by attacking Christians. And so, I think, there's, I don't want to necessarily say this is a paradox, but in some ways maybe it kind of is, that the devil is defeated. The ball game's over. Zero's on the time left. But he's still fighting, even though he knows this. And so even up to this point, whether or not he still thought he had a chance, whatever it was, whether he knew the significance of everything that was going on, he still did not think he was defeated. But here there was no doubt. I mean, the resurrected Jesus standing there face to face, that's just an awesome picture to envision. Oh, no doubt. Absolutely. Yeah, I mean, you think of all of our worst qualities as human beings. In a sense, that's where they all come from. They're embodied in him. And so he knows what our weaknesses are. If it's despair, he'll try and depress us. If it's pride, he'll try and build us up and make us boast in ourselves and be confident in ourselves and be arrogant to the point of, what do I need God for? Right? Look what I've accomplished for myself in my life. Absolutely. I think you're right. It no doubt accomplished that in a sense, and maybe even in a real, very real way, put the devil in his place. Right? Yeah. Yeah, I think that's a good way to look at it. So next time you're in worship and you hear us confess these words, now you'll know. Jesus descended into hell, and he went there to proclaim his victory. Not to suffer more, not to take people out of hell with him, to simply look at all who were there and say, I win. Sin and death are defeated. This is why Jesus can make the promise that he does. Whoever lives and believes in me will never die. Because I've gone to the place where you and I deserve to be when we die. And Jesus came back from it. So. Alright. No other questions then? Moving on to his resurrection. We already looked at this one, so we'll spend a lot of time on it. We have another great verse, 1 Peter chapter 1. In his great mercy, God has given us new birth into a living hope through the resurrection of Jesus Christ from the dead. Just some awesome phrases in that verse. A new birth, a living hope. You probably know, and you can maybe envision a time in your life when you had a dead hope. You were still wishful, but ultimately you knew there really is no hope. This is what it means to be connected to Jesus Christ. You have a living hope. It's alive and well. It is a hope that is safe and secure. Pastor Mitchell mentioned this in his sermon again on Sunday. The differences in the way the Bible uses the word hope, confidence. Something that God has promised, but you and I haven't experienced yet. So the Bible can talk about how we have the hope of eternal life as Christians. Not that we wish for it, or we're really, really kind of, you know, optimistic that it might happen. We have a living hope of eternal life. We have the assurance, the confidence. Heaven is my home. The only reason it's a hope is because I'm not there yet. And so maybe you remember the words, 1 Corinthians chapter 13, the great love chapter, right? Love is patient, love is kind, does not envy, does not boast. The end of that chapter, the Apostle Paul, or the end of that section, in verse 13, the Apostle Paul says, these three remain, faith, hope, and love. But the greatest of these is love. And people love that section because, oh yeah, just love is the greatest, right? Love is just the best. You know, you can't beat love. That's not what Jesus is talking about, or the Apostle Paul is talking about. You want to know why faith and hope do not remain? Because eventually the day will come when you will not need faith or hope. Faith is being sure of what you hope for and certain of what you do not see. The day that you open your eyes in eternal glory, you won't need faith anymore. Because you will see with your own eyes everything God ever promised you. You won't need hope anymore because you'll be experiencing exactly what God promised to give you and to be for you. And you will be exactly where He promised you would be. But love never goes away. In fact, in heaven, love will be for you what you always wanted it to be. And I'm not talking just about this emotional kind of love, but a love that does not, and does all the things that Paul talks about. Love that does not disappoint. Love that does not boast, that does not envy. Love that keeps no record of wrongs. Love in heaven will be something that you and I couldn't even begin to dream about. And we'll talk more about this in our lesson, what is it, lesson 10? We go over heaven, hell, judgment day, all those kinds of things. It's almost an impossible concept to picture in our minds what will heaven be like. Because the people who I meet there, I am going to have for them, and they will have for me, a greater love than I ever gave or received in this life. I will love in heaven someone who lived on the opposite side of the world in an entirely different century that I never even knew existed. I will have a greater love for him than I ever had for my wife. And he will love me with a greater love than my daughter will ever show me. Because where there is no sin, there is perfect love. So this idea of hope is just awesome. It's a living hope through the resurrection of Jesus Christ from the dead. Here's what we have. What's the significance? We look at these words again, John chapter 11. Jesus says, because I live, you also will live. So, Jesus' resurrection from the dead proves that I too will be raised, will have eternal life, because Jesus has gone ahead of me. He's paved the path. He's there and promises that I, through faith in him, will be as well. We're not going to look it up, but Acts chapter 1, we just encountered it a couple of weeks ago in church, this great festival in the Christian church, the ascension into heaven. Just kind of a Cliff Notes version, right? Jesus takes his disciples up onto a mountain, and there tells them, you will be my witnesses in Judea and Samaria and to the ends of the earth. And then he ascends before them. The clouds hide them from their sight. They're standing there staring at him. Right? Angels appear beside them. They're, why are you looking up into the sky? Right? He's going to come back in the same way that he left you. But remember what he just told you. You can't be his witnesses in the entire world if you never leave the mountain. So go. And we're told the disciples do. The point of this is now, so what? What's the significance of Jesus' ascension into heaven? John chapter 14. In my Father's house are many rooms, Jesus says, "If it were not so, I would have told you. I'm going there to prepare a place for you. And if I go and prepare a place for you, I will come back and take you to be with me, that you also may be where I am." There's just so much there. I mean, we could spend an entire hour just talking about that. I got the privilege of preaching on Ascension Sunday a couple weeks ago, and we looked at three reasons why the ascension into heaven need not or should not be a forgotten festival in the Christian church here. The Apostle Paul lays out a number of reasons that we looked at. And the first one was, it proves that Jesus' work for our salvation is complete. Remember, Jesus only comes, he only descends to earth, why? To accomplish the salvation of souls. So he only ascends back into heaven if what? That work is done. So it's a comforting thing. Jesus is leaving, that means it's done. His work as our Savior is finished. The second reason is ultimately here. To show us that he has gone to prepare a place in our eternal home. He's gone ahead of us. And you can use different kinds of analogies. You know, you think about it, right? When people are coming over, guests, they're coming over to your house, right? You have to prepare their room, right? Get the room ready. What does that mean? You clean it up, you make it look nice, maybe you put up some pictures, you know, that will mean a lot to them or whatever it is. That helps us maybe grasp. But ultimately, what does it mean that Jesus is preparing a place for you right now in heaven? I don't know. I can't put it into words. But isn't it just so awesomely comforting to hear that though we do not see Jesus face to face like the disciples and the people in first century Israel did, that Jesus has not forgotten about you? Because here's exactly what he's doing right now. He's preparing a place for you. And the point of that is so that when the day comes that you shut your eyes on this side of heaven and open them up on the other, that you will be where Jesus is. And for all of the things that we try and say, well, heaven will be like, or, you know, I hope there's this in heaven, or I hope I get to do this in heaven, none of those things will matter. Because ultimately, the only thing that will matter, and the only reason why I want to go to heaven, is because I know that's where Jesus is. And I've talked about it in the past. Family members of mine who aren't believers, I'd love to have them there in heaven with me. But ultimately, if they're not, Jesus will be. And he's the one I want to see. That last phrase, so that you will be where I am. That's the whole goal, right? I mean, that's what we looked at all the way back in lesson one. How do I get close to God? How do I know that I have this relationship with him? Here's Jesus saying it. The day's coming, and I've done everything necessary. So that when that day comes, and they put your flesh and your bones 6 feet under, you will be where I am. So, 40 days after his resurrection from the dead, Jesus ascended into heaven and is now preparing a place for you, so that you might be where he is. The second to last one that I think is also another confusing one. We confess this in the creed as well, that Jesus ascended into heaven and is seated at God the Father's right hand. Here's where we get that from. The Apostle Paul writes in Ephesians 1, that power is like the working of his mighty strength, talking about God the Father, which he exerted in Christ when he raised him from the dead and seated him at his right hand in the heavenly realms. What picture does that impress in your mind? Does that conjure up in your head? Draw it out for me. When you get to heaven and you see God, what picture does this paint in your mind? I'm assuming it's much like it does for me. You've got God the Father sitting there, right? Big crown, big throne, and then there's Jesus off to his right, maybe on a little smaller throne, looking a little younger, at the Father's right hand, right? That isn't what it means. The fact that we hear in Scripture that Jesus is sitting at God the Father's right hand is not to describe where Jesus is, but who Jesus is. Okay? Here's the significance. A couple of verses later in Ephesians 1, we hear God placed all things under Jesus' feet and appointed him to be head over everything for the church. This was the third reason, because this is the section we looked at on Ascension Sunday, Ephesians chapter 1. This was the third reason why the ascension of Jesus gave us reason to celebrate. Because all of our enemies have been placed under Jesus' feet. And I talked about a little bit of the history of that phrase. In ancient times, right, when a king would take his army off to battle, and you never wanted to kill the king of a foreign nation. You always wanted to keep him alive because he was your proof. So you'd capture the king of the nation that you defeated, and you'd bring him back, and you would lay out the defeated king as the victorious king gathered all of his people, right outside the palace, and the streets would just be packed. Imagine what it was like when the Kansas City Royals just won the World Series, where they have over 1 million people packed in downtown Kansas City. I mean, it's just a sea of blue and white as far as you can see. King would gather his nation in front of him, and he would lay out the defeated king in front of him, and he would walk up and just put his foot on the king's head. And it was symbolic, right? You get what that means. That he could just as easily pop that guy's neck or head off like a dandelion. This is what it means, that Jesus is now seated at God the Father's right hand. It's not where he is, it's who he is. Think about when we use that phrase still today, this is my right-hand guy. By that, do you mean that he's always there, right at your right-hand side? No, you're not talking about his location. You're talking about who he is, right? You're talking about you can talk to him, and he can make decisions just as I can. He has my power and my authority. He's my right-hand guy. Without him, I am not whole. I'm not complete. But he has all of my power, all of my authority. He can make those decisions. He can do those things just as if I myself were doing them. Jesus now, think about where he's come from. Going through his entire humiliation, his conception, his birth, his lowly life, his humiliating suffering and death. And now look at him. All power, all glory, all honor belong to Jesus. So when we talk about Jesus being seated at God the Father's right hand, we're not talking about where Jesus is, but who he is. He is the one true God who has all power, all authority, all honor, glory, and praise are his. Because he is at the Father's right hand. He is kind of the right-hand man, so to speak. Okay? So when we talk about Jesus, we can talk about God. When we talk about God, we're talking about Jesus. This is what we confessed in the Athanasian Creed on Sunday. Remember, we talked about that all the way back in Lesson 3. I always enjoy being able to go through that. It seems so simplistic, but I think it just beautifully walks through the mystery of the Trinity. And that's one of those phrases that we confess in the Creed on Sunday morning. The Father is almighty, the Son is almighty, the Holy Spirit is almighty. But there are not three who are almighty, but one who is almighty. So what you say about God the Father, you say about God the Son, right? When it comes to having all power. And this is what we see now, Jesus taking back all of his power and authority and honor that truly belong to him as true God. For a time he had set those aside, right? In his humiliation. Now he has them all back. Okay. So, Jesus now sits at God's right hand, an expression which means that he now has all power and authority. And all honor and glory belong to him. Okay. The last stage of Christ's exaltation is the one that has not happened yet. The one we're still waiting for. Matthew chapter 25, Jesus says, "When the Son of Man comes in his glory, and all the angels with him, he will sit on his throne in heavenly glory. All nations will be gathered before him, and he will separate the people one from another as a shepherd separates sheep from goats." Okay, so you get that analogy, right? And we'll talk more about this in an upcoming lesson, but what is the deciding factor? What is it that Jesus will look at and say, sheep, goat? Yeah. Whoever believes in him, in Jesus, will not perish, but have eternal life. The sheep are those who believe in Christ. The goats are those who do not. Here's the significance. Acts chapter 17, the apostle Paul is talking about in Corinth. He says, "God has set a day when he will judge with justice, judge the world with justice by the man he has appointed." Who is that? Well, he has given proof of this to all men by raising him from the dead. So who are we talking about? Jesus. Okay. Here's the significance of that, and maybe it's obviously clear. The purpose and significance of Judgment Day is that all people will be judged with justice, fairness, equality, by Jesus Christ. And here's the thing he'll be looking for. Faith or the lack of it. Okay. So, when Christ returns on the last day, he will judge the living and the dead. That's the final phrase that we confess in the Creed. Any thoughts, questions on that section? Any of those stages? Okay, let's then finish the lesson. Here's our summary. Jesus completed his work of redemption when he paid for the guilt of our sins by his death on the cross. His death and burial were the final stages of his humiliation. Once he had accomplished his goal to save the world from sin, he began his exaltation, meaning this: Jesus now makes full use of his divine power and glory as the Son of God. Jesus did not pay for our sins by his resurrection from the dead. We talked about that earlier. Rather, his resurrection proves that God the Father has accepted his Son's sacrifice as the perfect payment for our sins. Jesus' resurrection also proves that his words are true, that he is the Son of God, and that we will also rise from the dead on the last day. 40 days after his resurrection, Jesus made himself invisible to us when he ascended into heaven. Now he continually watches over us and prepares for the day when we will join him in heaven. We wait patiently and eagerly for his triumphant return, when he will take us and all believers to heaven. Here's our connection in our worship life. Next page. In Old Testament times, God assigned Saturday as the specific day that his people were to formally worship him. Saturday was the Old Testament Sabbath, or day of rest, that also provided an opportunity for God's people to assemble together in his name. The purpose of this specified day of rest was to give the people of Israel an earthly picture of the spiritual rest that the coming Savior would bring. Rest from our guilt, rest from our sins, rest from our trying to be good enough to make ourselves worthy of God. Okay? We get rest from all of that in Jesus. Once Jesus had fulfilled his mission on earth, the purpose of the Sabbath was no longer necessary. The specific intent of that day. In fact, the New Testament specifically states that no one should be condemned for not observing special days such as the Sabbath. Reference there is Colossians chapter 2, verse 16. the New Testament, so does that mean that ultimately what they did on the Sabbath, getting together, focusing on God's Word, reminding themselves of His promises, does that mean that all of that just went away then in the New Testament? No. Read the book of Acts. Read the Apostle Paul's letters. The New Testament does encourage us to gather together for worship. Hebrews chapter 10, verse 25. Let us not give up meeting together, as some are in the habit of doing. But let us gather and get together all the more as we see the day approaching. Judgment Day could be tomorrow. Judgment Day could be before this class is over. It could be on your way home tonight. And so what do I do with my time then, knowing that it could be at any waking moment? Well, I want to do all that I can to make sure that I am found in Christ. And so when I know there are places and people gathering around God's Word, reminding themselves of these promises, not only that Christ is returning, but that Christ has done everything necessary to prepare me for that return, where else would I rather be? Let us not give up meeting together. But that being said, it does not establish any specific times or rituals. Since the first days of the Christian church, Christians have generally chosen to gather for worship on Sundays. Sunday is the day on which Jesus rose from the dead, on the first day of the week the women set out for the tomb. And so every Sunday is considered a little Easter celebration. You ever thought of it like that? That's the whole reason why we gather on Sunday, is because of Easter. So really, every Sunday is a celebration of Easter. That's the whole point of it. That's why we gather on Sunday. Christians still have the freedom to establish other times for worship. And many churches offer services on other days of the week as well. We do on Thursday, for example. However, Sunday worship does provide a symbolic connection to the event that changed our lives forever, the resurrection of Jesus Christ. Okay? Let's get through the agree-disagree real quickly. Number one, Jesus resurrected himself from the dead. Yeah, we can say that. 1 Corinthians chapter 6, verse 4, 1 Thessalonians chapter 4, verse 13, they talk about Jesus rising from the dead in an active sense. Okay? There are other passages that talk about, we looked at one, other passages that talk about Jesus being made alive by the Spirit. Other passages that talk about, we looked at this one as well, Ephesians chapter 1, right? God the Father exerted that power in Christ when He raised Him from the dead. The point of it is to say, the Spirit raised Jesus from the dead, the Father raised Jesus from the dead, Jesus raised Himself from the dead. Because ultimately, who raised Jesus back from the dead? God. And who is God? Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. So, you can talk about it that way. Number two, the angel came down to let Jesus out of the grave. No, it wasn't Jesus banging on the rock, saying, "Let me out." The angel came down to be and do what angels do. The name or the word angel literally means a herald, a proclaimer. And so this is when you see angels function in Scripture. The angels are there at the most important moments of Jesus' life. They're there at His birth, proclaiming to the shepherds, right? Today in the town of David, a Savior has been born to you. He is Christ the Lord. The angels are there at the resurrection of Jesus. They're there at the tomb to tell the women, "He is not here. Why do you look for the living among the dead?" The angels are there at Jesus' ascension, right? Telling the disciples, "Stop looking up into the clouds. Get out there and preach." And we're told, as Jesus said, when the Son of Man returns and all of His angels with Him, they will be there when Jesus returns. Because they are there to proclaim, to be heralds, not there to accomplish something Jesus could not do in His own. Number three, Jesus descended to hell to give the people there a second chance to be saved. No. Disagree. We'll talk about that more in lesson 10. But we see that it was to preach His victory over sin, death, and devil. Number four, Jesus' resurrection. How do I have it? Change it. Four, Jesus' resurrection. This is dumb. I'm sorry. Jesus' resurrection did not pay for our sins. You should never put a negative in an agree-disagree statement because it makes it very confusing. I thought I'd change it, but I did not. Jesus' resurrection did not pay for our sins. Agree. It did not. Right. That was the point of it. When did Jesus pay for our sins? On the cross. Right. Yeah. His resurrection proves that his death paid for our sins in full.
Let me change that.
Number five. Jesus' resurrection proves that he is God.
Yep.
Who else can raise themselves back from the dead? Number six, Jesus' resurrection proves that our sins are paid for.
Yep.
Number seven, Jesus' resurrection proves that we will rise from the dead.
Yep.
Number eight, Jesus is still alive on the earth today. No, not in the same way that he once was. As much as Joan Osborne's 1990s hit, "What if God was one of us? Just a slob like one of us, just a stranger on the bus," right? You've seen, this is, what movie was it? Bruce Almighty, right? Morgan Freeman, who actually is probably closer in skin tone. I know a lot of people, you know, Jesus is not African American, because we've seen all of the Europeans paint him throughout history as a white guy. Well, he's not white either. I love all the paintings that make Jesus look like he's from, you know, Tennessee or something, or from the Midwest. No, Jesus is Middle Eastern. Okay, so probably his skin tone is probably closer to Morgan Freeman's than it was. Who was the guy that portrayed him in The Passion? Cavalia or whatever the guy's name is. Yeah, I can't. Anyway, my point is, the point I think of that was, you know, Jesus is just kind of wandering around, right, disguised as random human beings, right, the homeless guy and things like that. No, Jesus does not disguise himself as strangers in the world. He's in heaven. He's ascended, and that's where he is, body and soul. Number nine, after Jesus ascended into heaven, there was nothing more he needed to do for us. Well, in a sense, agreed, right? That's the whole point. That's why he ascends back into heaven, to show there isn't anything more that Jesus needs to do to accomplish my salvation. That being said, I don't want to have this picture in my mind that Jesus is just kind of kicking back on a lazy boy, right? Just kind of letting the world go to hell in a handbag, like so many of us think that it is. No, Jesus is still actively at work, both in the world and in heaven, right? Preparing a place for you. This is the picture that Jesus paints. So, he doesn't need to do anything to accomplish our salvation, but he's still working for us, right? Still accomplishing his will in our lives. Finally, number 10, we can always be sure that we will live with Jesus forever in heaven. You know, that really is the crux of the Christian faith. Pastor Mitchell mentioned it in his sermon on Sunday. Here's what really separates biblical Christianity from the religions in the world. When you royally screw up in this life, which we all have and all will, what does your religion or the object of your faith require you to do to make up for it? How do you fix it? The message of the gospel, the message of the Bible is, you don't. Jesus has. When Jesus says paid in full, he means that much. He means that as much as he did at your baptism, and maybe that was decades ago, as he does today, having 3, 4, 5, 6 decades worth of sin under your belt. He means it just as much now as he did then. The purpose of the faith, the Christian faith, what separates it is, because your salvation does not depend on you, your salvation is always secure. Because it does not depend on you, it is not hanging in the balance. And so this is why, you know, you look at the prophet Jeremiah, those great words, when the prophet says, a smoldering wick God will not snuff out, and a bruised reed he will not break. On those days when you feel like you have no faith, On those days when you feel like you've done something so horrible that God could never merit it, be sure of your salvation, because it does not depend on you. It depends on the one who lived and died and who lives again, and it's done. This is the beauty of the Christian faith, that you can always be sure of your salvation. You don't get that in every religion. You get a long list of, you know what, here are the things that you need to do to make up for it. Here are the things you need to do in order to secure your place in heaven. Here's the kind of man or woman or father or mother or employer or employee or son or daughter that you need to be if you want to have any hope of getting into heaven. There's no certainty in that. Because even on our best days, we are none of those things in the way that we could or should be. David.
Even if someone loses their saving faith, they can be sure, because I wrote that phrase down there, provided our saving faith is still there.
Sure.
I think if somebody loses their saving faith, I would say they will not. They should not be sure that they're going to live with Jesus.
You're right. There's a difference there. But I guess I'm looking at it more from the perspective of the way the Apostle Paul describes it in Romans 8. When he makes that promise, and you're right, there's this paradox. Again, Scripture is filled with it. There's this paradox where we find in Scripture the promises that God makes that no one can snatch them out of my hand. The promises that we hear that neither life nor death nor angels nor demons nor heights nor depths nor anything else in all of creation can separate us from the love of God that is in Christ Jesus. That is always being sure, right? That is the certainty that we have. But you're right. Then there are other places in Scripture where the encouragement is, don't fall away from faith, right? Because I can actively walk away from Christ, and I can actively and willingly reject my faith, and I can do those things. But I guess those are not the words that I share with someone who is that bruised reed or that smoldering wick, or someone who comes in and says, Pastor, I feel like I have no faith. I don't hark on them and say, well, how did you lose your faith? Right? The simple fact that you are afraid, that you've lost your faith, shows that your desire and your willingness to hear that proclamation again. And I love that analogy. You know, I've heard it, I don't know where it comes from, but this is where we'll end tonight. That the picture of a toddler walking with his father, right, on kind of an icy sidewalk. And the toddler is holding on to his father's hand. The first time he slips, he falls. Right? He gets back up and, you know, brushes himself off. He gets back up and holds on to his father's hand again, and hits another patch of ice and falls. And that's what so many people have as their picture for faith. I gotta hold on. I can't let go. I can't fall away. And if I do, and this is why you see so many people being baptized 3, 4, 5 times in their life, because I fell away, I let go, and I crashed down into the pits of my life. The third time, what happens? The father doesn't let the son hold on to his hand anymore. He holds on to the son's hand. And so when he slips, he doesn't. That's the picture that Paul uses in Romans 8. And that's the picture that I have with this statement, that we can live confidently knowing that our sins are forgiven, that we can live confidently knowing there is nothing else that needs to be done for our salvation to be secure. So here's the encouragement. Stay in that faith. Stay in God's Word. Remain connected to the means of grace, the gospel and word and sacraments. Make use of those things and those places where you know God is promising to strengthen your faith. Absolutely. Well, you're right. We do not believe, nor does Scripture teach, a once saved, always saved.
Yeah. Baptists, I think, do.
Yes. And many others.
If they lost their faith, they never really had it together.
Right. In many other religions, yeah. Certainly. So. Yes. Okay. Let's close tonight with a prayer. Gracious Lord Jesus, you are our exalted Lord and King. Thank you for giving us the opportunity to walk through these glorious stages of your exaltation, to watch as you proclaim your victory over Satan and hell, to watch as you rise back victoriously from the dead, as you ascend back to your and our eternal home, as you retain and take back all of your power and authority at the Father's right hand, and ultimately, Lord, we now eagerly anticipate for that final stage of your exaltation to come. The day when you will return to judge the living and the dead. The day when you will bring us home to our eternal glory. We thank you for these reminders, for this comfort, for this reassurance. Continue to give us this to us, Lord, day after day, week after week, that we might remain close to you, that we might remain safe in grace, as you have promised that we will. By your grace and according to your promises, we ask all of these things in your saving name. Amen.